Good afternoon. You just met Rod Hall with Emu, now meet Rod Hall with me, and some chips.
Yes, isn't that nice? Professor, you're finding my favourite fruit.
Well, you know that... quite. Nice, but you know that the funny thing about you is that since you've come into the studio today and met us all, you sort of create your own chaos. You do.
Me?
Yes. Personally. You didn't bring Emu today.
No.
Why not?
Oh, well, he's very tired. Mm. And I thought, well, he might... Well, I mean, it's a nice afternoon. It's nice coming to sit here and talk with you. I thought I wouldn't bring Emu just for a change, if you didn't mind.
I don't mind.
He's working very hard up at the Shaftesbury at the moment.
Because he's doing a lot of pantomimes. Mm. Smashing pantomime, by the way.
Well, only one pantomime.
Yes, but you do it a couple of times a day.
Yes, that's true.
That's what I meant. I thoroughly enjoyed it, by the way, because it's very, I mean, it's totally a child's world, of course. Like, some pantomimes aren't, but yours is.
Why did you say that you enjoyed it if it was a child's world? Did you like being in a child's world?
I think so. I mean, I like it as a complete escape, and it's simple and it's real.
Yeah.
And it's fantastic.
Thank you. Yes, I wanted to make it all of those things. I wanted to make it fantasy because I think it's missing. There's a great deal of it missing in our lives. And I wanted to make it real for them too. And I want the kids, when they go home, to tuck themselves up in bed and think of that world. Because I used to pull the covers over my head and play houses and make cakes and things and pretend people were coming round to eat them.
Did you ever tie the blanket up on the bed poles and be a tent? That's what I used to be.
I did that once in a hospital. I was in hospital. I was sent there to have... I had scarlet fever. And I got fed up because we were tucked up in bed and it was in wartime. It was awfully strict. And they said, the matron will be around in a minute on her rounds. And they went off. And I thought, well, it was time to play tents. by the time matron had come round, I had this huge tent erected up over my bed. The poor staff nurse went berserk.
Because they like tidiness in hospital.
They like it all tidy.
Emu doesn't like tidiness, does he? Emu is an anarchist.
Do you think he is? I suppose he is in a way, yeah. Yes, yes. All right. Well, I won't pursue that.
Can I pursue whether you are?
An anarchist? Mm. Good Lord, no. No, I don't think I am at all.
You like things to be neat and orderly and bureaucratic and...
No, oh no, no, don't let's get mixed up. I mean, when you say anarchy, I think anarchy is against what is sort of the standard. And I am opposed to anarchy when it threatens our way of life, yes. But then, in my own way, I suppose I am a little bit of an anarchist because I do not like... bureaucracy, but that's purely for me, you know, and I don't want to inflict it on anybody else. Anarchists seem to want to inflict it on everybody, and I don't want that.
Just before you came into the studio, the makeup said to you, you've only shaved half of your face.
Oh, you said you weren't going to say that.
No, it's just struck me that sort of slightly haphazard approach to things, though, is what your act with Emu is, isn't it?
It's thought out. Haphazard, I suppose, yes, because, see, I mean, I don't think anything runs to form, do you? I mean, nothing...
Nothing nice runs to form, I think.
Well, no, yes, exactly. If it goes amiss and goes awry, then I think it's all the better for it. It has more value.
You know, you get about 200 letters a day addressed to Emu, don't you? How many people think Emu's real?
Many. Many people think Emu's real. I had a little kid come backstage the other day and she said, I want to see Emu. And I said, oh, Emu's fast asleep at the moment because he's been working very hard on the show. And she says, don't say that because he's a puppet, you see. And I thought, there's one kid that doesn't want to believe in this. It's going to sit there and say that's a puppet. And I thought, well, okay, I'll try and still have some bit of fantasy if I can for her. I said, oh, yes, it's a puppet skin, but I've got a real emu inside. And she went, oh. And then we won. I mean, we reached a sort of compromise.
You know. Did you have a kind of emu when you were a child? Because my theory about emu, sorry to have a theory, because you hate them, I think.
Yes.
My theory is that... I have a chip.
Go on,
Is that emu is the sort of thing in a child... You know when a child says... You say to the child, you've done this, you naughty girl, yeah. Naughty boy.
Yes.
And the child said, I didn't. Yeah. It wasn't me. Yeah. It was, and they name somebody, don't they?
Yes, my daughter, my eldest daughter, Deborah, who's about 15 and a half now, said that to me once. And I...
What did she say then?
Well, I blamed her for something, and she said it wasn't me, it was Tukshu and Kika. And of course, you see, a parent, at least for me, then I didn't have any sort of depth of feeling, I don't think.
What?
Because
why not?
Because I didn't believe in Tukshu and Kika, but she really believed in it, and she said, it wasn't me, it was Tukshu and Kika. And I, like an angry parent, said, oh, don't be so stupid, it was you, and you're going to get, you know, a smack for that, which is awful, and you shouldn't really do that, and I'm so sorry I've done that in my life, in one way. And then in another way, I'm glad I've done it, because I've seen the error of my ways, and I now know that there is fantasy things, and they are very real, and they're very necessary, too. And my little girl grew out of it because she said to me one day, many years later, Daddy, Tukshu's dead and Kika's in hospital. And I said, oh, I'm very sorry to hear that. But see, I was, at that stage, you say, no, it's very black and white. Whatever it was she'd done is spilt or is broken, and you were here, now you did it, didn't you? And she said, no, it was Kika and Tukshu. I should have believed her. I should have said yes.
Because apparently the children only keep hold of those little things until they can adjust to being naughty as well as good. Well, so the theory is, I don't know.
Well, I don't know if that's right. I think that they keep hold of them until they're forced into this machine of life, which is learning and school and work, and you all get shoved into here, and when you come out you're going to be anything from doctors and lawyers, shop assistants, hairdressers, whatever, you come out. And in that, you must lose a hell of a lot of realism. And when I say realism, it's real realism. It's children, young children. There's nothing more beautiful to me than the innocence of children and the want to believe. I think it's a great shame that they have to go out into the world and get tarnished by worldly things. I've done it. I mean, we've all done it. And it's only now that I can look back and say, well, I don't really want that anymore, and if I can offer something to untarnish it, if I can offer something to say, look, there is a world of fantasy, and do believe in it, because it is real.
You left home, didn't you, so that your children haven't grown up with you as they...
I left my wife and children, yes, about 5 or 6 years ago. They've now grown up. I've got my daughter's now 15 and a half, and the other one's 10. I mean, I see them regularly. We sort of chat over the phone. It's a very difficult life for me because I am all over the place. But when I can see them, I do.
But you were telling me you were glad she was going to see you just at this present moment.
Oh, yes, she phoned me last night, actually, my daughter, and said, Daddy, I want to come and speak to you about my career. And I said, fine, that'd be lovely. And I'm glad that she's come to me to say that because it's, you know, whatever sort of... what's the word I'm looking for? However one views somebody else, it takes time for you to realise that there are two sides to everything, and that perhaps Daddy was acting in the right way when he left home, and so now it is a very honest and very friendly relationship, and I love that very much. To me, that has much more value than being parent.
Do you live on your own now?
I live on my own part of the time, and I live. Some of the other time with a very nice lady who I like very much.
Does that work? Because, I mean, doesn't one of you want to be together all the time? I'm always fascinated by people who say, well, it does work. You can go your way and she can go mine. Can it work?
Yes, I think it's, and it's very real working because you don't lose respect, I don't think, then. I lead very much my own life. And this person who I'm attached to leads her life, very much her own life. Yet we can meet each other and be together, meet for meals, and even live together for a while, if you like. But at all times, you are not joint. You are singly your own person. And because you are singly your own person, I constantly have respect for what she does. And I think, and I hope, vice versa. And I think, what a lovely way to live. For me, Whether it's right for anybody else, I don't know. People have to find their own things that make them feel happy. And I think that's the basis. If you are happy, if you're doing what you want to do, then, you know, there's really nothing else to look at. Is there?
Not really, no. I mean,
that is my one question I ask myself, no matter what I'm doing, in work or in life or anything. If I can say to myself, am I happy doing this? And if the answer is no, then I must stop.
And you will stop,
and I will.
You won't,
yes,
do it against the grain.
I walk away from things. Not because I'm frightened, but because I say to them, honestly, I said, look, I know that you've asked me to do this, and I said I would, but since being here, you know, it really isn't me, and I don't want to know about it. It's not making me happy, and I'm going to go. And after all, that is only a worldly thing. Well, when you think about sort of living within the social system, you must do this, and you must do that. If I really don't agree, then I feel I must say to them that I don't agree. It's only man-made rules that tend to make you conform and be channeled once again into this thing, which I think kids all get sort of channeled into. I think people should step outside of that and really look at it and ask themselves the question, am I happy? And if the answer's no, then for goodness sake, do something about it and make yourself happy.
When you live in Kent, which is where you were born, wasn't it?
Yeah.
And you live back in a place quite near to where you were born.
Mm-hmm.
And you've got a place, a little place, cottage or a house.
Little cottage.
And you grow vegetables.
Yes. Chips.
Potatoes mainly.
Yeah. Well, everything.
Do you sort of, I mean, do you need to be on your own?
Yes, I do. A hell of a lot.
Mm.
And I need to be on my own for many, many reasons. Obviously, I like being alone. I think and I write. Hopefully, I get enough input into me that people who want me to be with them see that person. Can you understand what I mean? I'm getting back to the marriage thing again. You see, with a marriage, if you're a joint thing, then you sort of tend to want to please all the time, and you become shallow for that. And I don't want to become shallow. At least I do.
You can argue that sometimes when you want to please somebody, you're not getting shallow, you're getting deep too.
I mean, getting deep, yes.
Well, in a way.
Yes, in a way. But if it goes on for too long and you find yourself giving in to things, then I think you might find yourself getting shallow. And the thing that you were attracted to in the beginning is not there anymore because that person isn't right anymore. They're not being themselves.
But being yourself is something very important to you then, is it?
Yes, I think it should be to everybody.
Mm. It can't be quite so important to you if you've got children to bring up or if you've got a husband to
look after. Oh, of course.
I'm not saying
be irresponsible. Mm. I mean, one can be responsible and have a sort of happy relationship within oneself. Yeah, I think that's that can be done. But it's not an easy task to do, and it's finding it. And it's finding your own level and being happy with yourself and knowing, yes, I can confidently do that. And then I think that's... Am I sounding more sort of profound?
No, you're not. You're sounding very nice. But I'll tell you another thing that that you told me, that you really are shy, are you?
Mm.
And that you really had an impediment which stopped you actually talking once, didn't it?
Speaking. Yes, I had an awful sort of stammer, which is there on occasion when I'm nervous and when I am not confident. I think that's what it is. And I think it's all a matter of self-confidence.
What age were you when you had that stammer then? And what were you doing at the time?
I don't know. I think I was about 9. It was the end of the war. 10. And it just sort of happened from then till I was about 17.
Did you have a happy childhood?
An odd childhood. We didn't live in a very sort of rich area. We were quite poor. It was odd because the war was on and Mum and Dad were apart and I got evacuated to Wales and to your part of the country, in fact, to Bargoed, which is a hideous place, isn't it? Sorry, all you Bargoed people. It's not really good. And they sent me there to get away from the bombs, but they were bombing it just as badly over there as they were where I was. So it wasn't so hard. And I went to a Welsh school where they spoke... Is it Gaelic? what is it?
Celtic.
Celtic. I'm awfully sorry. I'm ignorant as well. And they say, all you boys from London, put your heads on the desk and go to sleep. We have to do this. And they were chanting away.
What, why they taught you Welsh?
No, they wouldn't speak to us in Welsh or anything. And so I used to leave school very early and go and help the dustman, because the dustman had a thing with two bins on and about five brooms. And I used to say, can I have one of your brooms? And he'd go, yes. And I used to go up the road with him, sweeping.
Did you mitch from school a lot when you were young then? Did you not go to school?
No, I was very good. One of the things that sticks in my mind from my childhood, or from school, is injustice. And that's a thing which I'm really against now. And I do try to be just all my life, and I do try to be honest with people and fair with, and I even say things to people like, I say, yes, I did say that. I must admit I did say it, but I said it because of this. And I think if you can say that with people, then they know where they are with you. And getting to this school thing, this unjust thing that happened to me, and really played on my mind. I had a school teacher who was a very strict woman, and we were all lined up in the playground. And she came up and she said, quiet! Of course, everybody kept quiet. And the guy next to me, the little boy next to me, I was about six at the time, seven at the time, carried on talking. And she came up to me and she hit me round the legs, because I only had short trousers on. She said, I said, quiet. I said, it wasn't me. And she hit me again. She said, I said, quiet. I said, but it really wasn't me. And she kept hitting me. And I said, I wasn't speaking, I really wasn't speaking. And she kept hitting me and said, I'm going to hit you until you say it was you. You know, now, isn't that hideous? Mm. It's almost Dickens, isn't it? It makes you feel ever so weepy. So I was trying to be honest and say, it wasn't me, it really wasn't me. I was getting hurt. And by getting hurt, I thought, you're crying. Don't
it's
cry.
Easier, no, it's easier to say that you are guilty, you see, this is awful.
So I said,
awful.
It was me. All right, it was me. And so the hitting stopped, but that stuck in my mind. And you know, many years later, I was an apprentice electrician. And I was working in this thoroughfare, in this arcade, on some scaffolding. And I had to cut a hole in this roof to fix up some lights, and I had this huge box, which I was knocking all the plaster into, and the dust of years and old bird's nest and muck and stuff's all in this box, and I was just going to carry it down the ladder, and I looked down, and my old schoolmistress was walking underneath, and I thought, oh, it's real, it's justice, and I tipped the lot over the top. He went straight down on top of this poor woman. And I ran for my life.
And we're running for our lives. Can we say goodbye with Emu?
We're not finished.
Yes, we are. Oh, where's Emu then?
Well, he's always. Emu, are you there?
There he is.
I told you, he's always there.
I know, I'm glad.